Good morning. Welcome to the worship here at the Little Church and Lakewood Grace. We are so glad you are here. There is no other place God would rather have you to be than right here in God's house, worshiping God, whether you're worshiping at home or watching this on the road on your phone. We are so glad we get to be able to be together like this. Hey, there's a couple of announcements I want to let you know about. One is on August the 2nd, we will be live casting at 11 a.m. And so we will have the worship services on both web pages after Sunday, August the 2nd, so that you can watch on our web page anytime. But we are going to be live casting at 11 a.m. There won't be a 9 a.m. Only at 11 a.m. on August the 2nd, and that's our communion Sunday. So please get your communion elements ready, as well as we're going to have a practice run on the live casting, because in September, our plan is to live cast at 9 a.m. From the Little Church on the Prairie webpage, a traditional worship, and at 11 a.m., the Lakewood Grace worship. And so this is a practice run for us. And then another exciting thing that's happening on that day is that we will be receiving 8 new members. And we will have our session and some deacons here to receive them on behalf of the congregation. And we will have 2 adult baptisms. It's going to be a fantastic Sunday, and we look forward to having you with us. But do want to let you know, it will only be at 11 a.m. as a live cast, and we will give you further instructions for that. And then finally, we want to invite you to join us in prayer, whether in person or whether you join me on Zoom. I host a prayer meeting every Wednesday to pray for our country, for our nation, and for our city and her leaders, and for our church and our members. And so please join me in prayer on Wednesday evenings at 6:30. And if you want to join me on Zoom, you need to comment on the comment form down below or contact the office so that they can give you access to Zoom. And so at this time, join me in a word of prayer as we get ready to worship. Let us pray. Oh God, we give you thanks for this day. Lord, you know, I am reading that record numbers of Americans are self-declaring that they are depressed at this time. And the depression numbers during this season, Lord, are the highest that it's ever been. And as long as Americans have been recording the numbers of people who are saying that they're depressed. Lord, this season has been a funky one for us. And it's not that we don't know that you are in control, nor that you are God and that you are loving. It's just, this has been hard. And so God, hear our laments, hear our complaints. Some of us are not doing well. And so God, we ask for your presence, for your healing, for your comfort and your strength. Man, bring this season to an end. Lord, at this time we come before you as repeat sinners in need of your forgiveness. So God, wash us again with your cleansing blood, reminding us of who we are as your sons and daughters. So God, we confess our silent prayers of confession before you right now. Friends, hear and believe the good news. By the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ shed for you and for me on Calvary, our sins are indeed forgiven. Amen. Amen. Hey, I'm going to hand this over to our children's ministry right now for our children's message. And so here we go.
Hi, kids. Today we are at Owens Beach right here in Tacoma. This is a great beach for collecting rocks, which is why I brought my 2 favorite guys, my takeout Jesus and my husband Scott. Anyone who knows Scott knows that he loves collecting rocks, and this is a great place for it. The rocks here at Owens Beach are round and smooth. They're perfect for skipping rocks, and they're also perfect for a slingshot. Today's story is actually about rocks in a slingshot. You can find this story in 1 Samuel chapter 17, and you can also find it in most children's Bibles. Our story starts with a great battle between God's people, the Israelites, and the Philistines. But the Philistines had a secret weapon. Actually, not such a secret. They had a giant named Goliath. And that giant was actually 9 feet tall. Now, the tallest living person right now is just over 8 feet, and Goliath was a full foot taller than that. And not only was he tall, but he was strong, and he was scary, and he was mean. And he came out one day and he said to the Israelites, "Send one person out to fight just me. If the Israelites win, we, the Philistines, will be your slaves." Well, the Israelites were kind of freaking out, wondering who could possibly defeat Goliath all by themselves. And as they were panicking, along came a young man named David. Now, David was a shepherd. Most of the time, he was out by himself taking care of the sheep. But on this day, he had come to bring food to his brothers, who were soldiers. And when he heard that they needed someone to fight Goliath, he said, "I'll do it." Well, none of them thought that little David could possibly defeat Goliath, but no one else was willing, so they let him give it a try. Goliath had a full set of armor, so the Israelites decided that David should have that too. So they put a heavy helmet on his head, they gave him a shield and a huge sword, and once he got all that on, well, it weighed as much as he did and he could hardly move. So he said, "I don't need this. In fact, I've got a better plan." And he picked up 5 smooth stones and his slingshot. And he put a stone in his slingshot and sent it round and round. One of those rocks from David's slingshot hit Goliath right in the forehead. And that big, strong giant came tumbling down, defeated by David and his slingshot. Now, was David really, really lucky? Was Goliath not that strong after all? Neither. David had God's help, and God was able to help David do what seemed impossible. Psalm 28:7 says, "The Lord is my strength and my shield. My heart trusts in him, and he helps me." And do you know who wrote that psalm? David did. God can help you, friends, do anything that he has set out for you. All you need to do is trust and obey. Have a great week, kids. Peace be with you.
Well, good morning, friends. Thank you for joining us today. Hey, our passage today is fantastic, and my prayer is that by the time we're done with this service, by the time you hear God's word proclaimed today, you are filled with hope. That's what our passage is about today. Now, we are in our second week here. Third week of 1 Peter. It's one of those. And our text today begins 1 Peter 13, 1 Peter 1, chapters 13 through 21. So I'm going to read that to us now. So hear now the word of the Lord to you and to me. "Therefore, with minds that are alert and fully sober, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. But just as he who called you was holy, so be holy in all you do. For it is written, 'Be holy because I am holy.' Since you call on a Father who judges each person's work impartially, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear.
For you know that it was not with perishable things, such as silver or gold, that you were redeemed from the empty way of life handed down to you from our ancestors, but with the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him, you believe in God who raised him from the dead and glorified him, and so your faith and hope are in God. This is the word of the Lord. You will notice there in verse 13, we begin our text today with therefore. And anytime you read or you hear therefore, you have to ask the question, what is the therefore, therefore? So before this, you can read what Peter has written to the church, but he writes therefore, and he lists things that God has done. And now we get to the therefore, because God has shown us his great mercy. Verse 1:3, in his great mercy, he has shown sinners like you and me mercy. So what have we received because of God's mercy? He has given us new birth into a living hope. The living hope, the source of our hope, is alive today in Jesus Christ. Through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, because of those things, therefore. Therefore, how do we live this hope? We're told to set our hope. And I want to talk about hope here for a little bit. We have hope in ways that we understand it. And then we've got hope as presented in God's word. Now, hope like we understand it, this kind of worldly hope, is something like this. It's sort of like wishful thinking that you want to grow to fruition, right? So I hope this idea that I want to present at work goes over well. It might not, right? I hope I have enough funds in the bank to cover this expense. I hope this works, right? This isn't hope like we encounter in God's word. This kind of hope that we put so much energy in is really like wishing a long shot will work out. And it actually isn't hope at all. It's more like wishful thinking. Lord, I hope the state patrol that I just sped past didn't see how fast I was going. I hope this sermon doesn't flop. Now, let's talk about biblical hope. Biblical hope is an expression of faith based on a certainty. Hebrews 16:9, the author of Hebrews writes this, "We have this as a sure and steadfast anchor of the soul." What anchors the soul? Hope. Hebrews 11:1, "Now faith is the assurance of things hoped for, the conviction of things not seen." Now, several things here about God-given hope. When we talk about hope used in the Bible, we are talking about things that are certain. Bank on them. Faith is the assurance of things hoped for. You see, so what is hoped for can be hoped for because it is assured, it is certain. One theologian wrote this, "Hope is faith looking to the future with the full assurance that God will do what he promises to do." Hope, this certain and assured hope, this biblical hope that nothing here on this earth can match, this kind of hope that Peter calls us to set our minds on is given to you and to me through Jesus Christ. We are given a living hope. Hope through Jesus Christ. And I want to pause here. Let's sort of take a hope inventory, shall we? What are you setting your mind on that gives you hope? Are you hoping for a better job? For better health? Are you hoping to be renewed through maybe a vacation coming up, if you can do that right now? Through somebody else, a friend, a family member. These are all well and good things, right? I'm not discounting these things, but listen, if we place our hope in anything less than Jesus Christ, we will never, ever be satisfied. And for Christians who are suffering, we need something greater to hope in than what we encounter here, especially now. And so Peter reminds us, we hope in a Savior. We hope in God's assurance that he is going to complete what he set out to complete, that God is not done with us yet, that God is going to return and usher in a new heaven and a new earth, that because of what Jesus has done for you and for me on the cross, spiritual death here and hell later are not our realities. So then he says, set your hope, this grounded in Jesus hope, set that hope on the grace, this unmerited favor that we don't deserve. Set your hope on this grace that is to be brought to you when Jesus Christ is revealed at his coming. Set your hope on this. Set your hope on this, church, that you who were once enemies of God, you have been reconciled to God by the death of his son. And now that we are reconciled, we shall be saved. That's Romans 5:10. So here's what Peter is saying. To the church who is struggling, who are suffering, set your hope on the grace to be brought to you when Jesus is revealed at his coming. That's why. Because we know that Jesus is coming. That's why we know that it's bad now, but that we have the audacity to say that it's getting better. It's going to get better, that the best is yet to come. Jesus is coming to judge perfectly every injustice, to heal every wound, to banish Satan and evil to hell forever, to make all things new. Better days are ahead. But until that happens, as we live in this in-between time of God's kingdom being present but not yet in its full expression until Jesus returns, you will suffer. You may very well lose your life for the gospel, but Jesus is coming. You will live through a pandemic. You may get sick through this pandemic. You may die in this pandemic, but Jesus is coming. You may not have the capacity for one more Zoom meeting in you, but Jesus is coming. You may be persecuted for Christ's sake. You may be ridiculed for Christ's sake, but Jesus is coming. Your body may never cooperate with you, and you may live a life of physical pain, but Jesus is coming. The results are in and they're positive, and you have cancer or ALS or Alzheimer's or whatever it is that will change your life forever. Listen, Jesus is coming. This is why we as Christians have the nerve to tell one another that the best is yet to come, because it really is. Until then, life will be hard. You know this. And we will suffer. This is nothing new to you. Don't expect anything less, but know that God uses suffering to refine our character, to make us more and more like Jesus. And remember the audience of Peter's letter. Remember Christians who are actively suffering. Here's a truth that they hoped onto that we can hope today. You cannot be formed in the character of Jesus Christ without suffering. God never lets that go to waste. So, okay, you who have been given a new hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. You who live in a harsh world, you who Peter calls to roll up your sleeves and get ready for action by setting our hope on the grace that is coming to us when Jesus Christ returns. How do we live out this hope? How does your hope become tangible? How is your hope expressed? Well, here's what Peter writes. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. He starts there. As obedient children. That's one clue. How about this? Could obedience spring out of hope? Can hope spring out of obedience? Peter seems to suggest that, friends. As obedient children, do not conform to the evil desires you had when you lived in ignorance. You see, there was a time before Jesus came into your life when you had no hope, or you had your hope placed in the wrong things. A time before Jesus when you lived in ignorance. A time before you knew what grace was, what hope was. A time before Jesus gave you a new heart and transformed your mind. Don't conform to the world around you, writes Peter, and go back to living like you did before when you had no hope. You see, you went from a life of sin and death, which Peter called your formal life of ignorance, and now you're into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So our response, the way we live out our hope, is to trust and obey. It's to be obedient by not conforming to the evil desires around us, but to repent from those urges and desires and those natural appetites of our old lives and surrender to Jesus and let the Holy Spirit work in our lives. And by doing that, we are living out our hope. Here's the thing. Peter calls us to be holy. So I want to take a little exercise here. You can do this in the comfort of your own home. Nobody's going to laugh at you as you try to do this. But I want you to try this. I want you to try right now, wherever you are, however you're listening or watching, I want you to try really hard to be as holy as you can. Okay? Let's take a second or two to do that. Ready? Let's just take 3 seconds to try to be holier. Here we go. Are you holier? No? Maybe? Let's try harder. Why don't we take a few more seconds and let's try harder this time to be holy. And while you're doing this, don't think any bad thoughts. Ready? Go. Anything? Did anybody watching pop a halo? If you did, let us know through the comments below. Send a picture or else it didn't happen. But here's the thing. As one of your pastors, I tried really hard to be holier there, and I still have no halo. You know why? Because if it's left up to me and my efforts, it's impossible for me to be holy. If it's left up to you and your efforts, and you try to be better on your own, you can't do it. Every time I try on my own to be more holy, a funny thing happens. I fail every single time. I cannot be holy on my own, and you can't either. You see, we need the indwelling of the Holy Spirit to transform us into new creations, and that is precisely what happens to us when we submit to Jesus as Lord. We become holy in God's eyes. You need Jesus to be holy. You see, when Jesus takes over our lives, we receive his holiness. This is how you become holy. It's not your holiness that impresses God and transforms the way you think. It's Christ's holiness that in you pleases the Father and glorifies him, because Jesus is everything we cannot be. Jesus did everything we could not do. And when God sees us through Jesus Christ, he doesn't see our sins and our wickedness. He sees his Son, and he sees holy people, the likeness of his Son. So you want to be holy? Here's how you become holy. You can't do it outside of Jesus Christ. You've got to repent from your sins. You surrender to Jesus as Lord, and you trust and obey. Now, why do we obey? Because we've been redeemed, says Peter, and you cannot pay that debt back on your own, but we can live. Since you call on a Father who judges each person's work impartially, writes Peter, live out your time as foreigners here in reverent fear, for you know that it was not with perishable things such as silver or gold that you were redeemed from the empty way of life. Now, to be redeemed meant that somebody else paid for your freedom. This is a commerce term here. So you are enslaved. You are enslaved, and you cannot pay that debt. So somebody, a third party, comes in and pays the debt that you cannot pay. And because that debt has been paid, you receive freedom. That's the economic language that Peter is using here. If you were a slave to an owner, you couldn't pay your own debt. You had to have a redeemer who could pay a price that you could not. So what purchased your freedom from this sin and death? Is it gold and silver? Asks Peter. No, listen, it's the precious blood of Christ, a lamb without blemish or defect. He was chosen before the creation of the world, but was revealed in these last times for your sake. Through him, through Jesus, you believe in God. It's not even something you can do on your own. It's through him you believe in God. Him who raised you from the dead and glorified him, and so your faith and hope are in God. So what has God done? Peter tells us, God has shown us his mercy. And what have we received as the beneficiaries of God's mercy? We have received a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead and into an inheritance that can never perish, spoil, or fade. And I would rather live here in this turmoil. I would rather live here in this time of uncertainty with the hope that Peter reminds us that we have that is grounded in Jesus Christ. I'd rather live here in this turmoil with that hope instead of finding hope in the temporal things that we see around us. So how do we live out this hope in a terrible world? We set our hope on the grace of Jesus Christ, who is coming back. We live holy lives, not because we have it in us on our own to be holy, but because Jesus is holy. To be holy in God's eyes, we repent of our sins, we surrender to Jesus Christ, and we live lives that are different. That's what holiness is. We trust and obey. That's how you live holy lives, grounded in the hope of Jesus Christ. And I want you to notice how, you know, we tend to overcomplicate things. And really what Peter is saying is actually quite simple. Peter doesn't give us a list of things for suffering people to achieve their best lives. Peter doesn't say, find your best self now and thrive. He doesn't offer ways for Christians to fight back against the injustices that are happening to them. He doesn't call for protests or revolt. He reminds Christians of what Jesus has done. He reminds Christians of the hope that they now have because of what Jesus has done. And he reminds them that because of Jesus, they are different. And so in an upside down, evil, unjust, scary world, their faith and their hope are grounded in God. And they live that hope through their obedience. And friends, may it be so with us. Listen, if you've heard this sermon, if you've sat and you were patient the whole time and you didn't fast forward or anything, listen, God is speaking to you. And if you are a part of the church, if you are a confessing Christian, may today be a day of hope and recalibration for you because we need this. And you need to tune in next week. We all have to be reminded of who God is and what he is doing and to whom we belong. But if you have not yet surrendered to Jesus Christ, what are you waiting for? You cannot find any kind of hope that is even close to this anywhere outside of Jesus Christ. And so my prayer for you, my hope for you, is that today, as you listen to this, you bend a knee, you repent of your sins, and you say, Jesus, come into my life and make me new. And I promise you, not because I promise you, but based on what is in God's word, better days are ahead. And no matter what you encounter, the best is yet to come. Let's join now in a word of prayer. Lord, we thank you for your hope. We know, God, you are merciful, even when we try to put our hope in things that fade. But because of you, we are given an inheritance that will never perish, spoil, or fade. We are given a living hope, and we know, God, that we can set our hope on you. You are coming back. And so, Lord, between when you appeared and when you are coming back, here we are in this world, and it is messy, and it is dirty, and it is all kinds of messed up, Lord. Help us be obedient. Lord, we surrender to you. Make us holy. May we glorify you in all that we do, even now. We love you. We pray these things in Jesus' name, the source of our hope. And all of God's people said, amen.
Pastor Brad, thank you so much for God's word, speaking God's word and encouragement to us at this time. Hey, friends, we have now the opportunity to respond to God's word. And I want to ask you to think about a couple of ways to respond. One is certainly our tithes and offerings. But, you know, that's only a part of it. Even in the midst of this pandemic, God wants to use you to be an agent of blessing. And our faith needs to be activated. And so I want you to think about some practical ways that God can use you to be a blessing and an encouragement to your neighbor and the people around you. Because it's not enough to just sit back. We need to engage. We need to exercise our faith. And that's part of our responding to God's word. Even in the midst of this pandemic, we can figure out, and it's our task as Christians to figure out how we can most bless our neighbors, and our family members and friends around us. And so I want to encourage you to do that. Hey, at this time, we are given the opportunity to present our tithes and offerings to God. And you can do that in multiple ways. You can mail that in, drop it off at the office. You can go to our webpage. On our webpage, on both the Lakewood Grace site and the Little Church site, there's a section that says give. Or you can text L Grace Give to 77977. And we want to encourage you to do that because that allows us to continue to do our ministry. So thank you for your ongoing support. At this time, join me in a word of prayer as we dedicate our tithes and offerings and our church and ourselves to God at this time. Let us pray. Hey, dear God, thank you so much for your grace and for your sovereignty. Thank you for being a God who provides for us. Thank you that we get to give. Thank you, Lord, that our folks are staying healthy and well. God, we lift up to you our country, for there are many who are suffering, millions, wondering how they're going to make ends meet, and millions wondering how they're going to support their families. Millions wondering when they can see their loved ones again because of this virus. Oh God, we ask for your mercy. Help us to quickly find effective treatments. And Lord, help our researchers to find a vaccine that can help us to get back. Lord, we lift up to your country, our president and her leaders. We ask for wisdom. We ask, Lord, for our soldiers who are many, tens of thousands, battling this disease as well, this virus as well. Lord, keep our soldiers safe. Lord, we lift up to you our first responders and those in the front lines of battling this virus in the healthcare business and hospitals. Lord, we lift up to you those who are involved in the food chain, without which, Lord, we could not survive, and yet many of them are being impacted in huge ways by this virus. Lord, have mercy. Lord, we lift up to you our educators as they discern what to do in the fall and what's best for our kids and our families. Lord, finally, we lift up to you the little church on Lakewood Grace. Even in the midst of this, God, we ask that you would grow your impact and your influence in this ministry, God. We trust that you are able, more than able, to do that, to encourage your saints, to grow your saints, to help us to mature. So God, we ask that you do that on our behalf. We thank you so much. And now we pray the prayer in which you taught your disciples to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. And all of God's people said, amen.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain, how I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows of my soul. The work is finished, the end is written. Jesus Christ, my living hope. Who could imagine so great a mercy? What heart could fathom such boundless grace? The God of ages stepped down from glory to wear my sin and bear my shame. The cross is spoken, I am forgiven. The King of Kings calls me his own. Beautiful Savior, I'm yours forever. Jesus Christ, my living hope. And hallelujah, praise the one who set me free. Hallelujah, death has lost its grip on me. Silence, the roaring lion declared the grave has no claim on me. Let's sing it again. Then came the morning that sealed the promise. Your buried